When I came to work here, I found that most everybody, if you said Jefferson Barracks, it was a cemetery. Jefferson Barracks was originally 1,702 acres given to the United States government. The name came about because Thomas Jefferson, a lot of people, certainly Confederates, like to say Jefferson Davis, and this was his first duty station after he graduated from West Point in 1828, but it was named for Thomas Jefferson. It opened in June of 1826. It was a good deal for everybody because the government got a place with lots of wood here, limestone, which was quarried 50 yards from here, and a waterway, which was the main highway. It became the first infantry school of practice. Very nice way of saying boot camp. Jefferson Barracks sent troops out and they fought in every war that the United States was involved in. Between the Blackhawk War in 1832 up through, actually, National Guard troops went out to Afghanistan.
So it's an important post, and it's very important because of all the equipment and material and men that transfer through here. Westward expansion really emanates from where you're standing. Everything the U.S. Army was using was shipping from here to points west. For example, the 6th Infantry Regiment is going to ship from here. The 1st Missouri Volunteers are going to ship from here. The brand new Regiment of Dragoons, they're going to leave from here. In fact, the brand new Regiment of Dragoons is organized and raised here. In many regards, Jefferson Barracks is the birthplace of American Cavalry. Another important point in the history of Jefferson Barracks is our role in the creation of Buffalo Soldiers. There were some integrated units in the Continental Army during the American Revolution, but for the most part, the United States Army is segregated. We don't have troops of African-American origin until the time of the American Civil War, when they're serving in volunteer formations known as U.S. Colored Troops. After the war, it's decided to create 4 regiments of African-American troops, 2 of cavalry, 2 of infantry. 3 of those regiments, the 24th Infantry and the 9th and 10th Cavalry, were organized here at Jefferson Barracks. The 9th and 10th Cavalry, of course, have got a dramatic history. They're the ones really known as the Buffalo Soldiers.
It was turned over to the medical department during the Civil War, so there were lots of people here. There were over 30,000 patients in Jefferson Barracks General Hospital during the Civil War.
The Civil War hospital stood till about 1902, and during the Second World War, there was the medical department had about 12,000 people working at Jefferson Barracks. One of the nurses' barracks still stands over on Hancock. Going on with this theme of how things change, we have the introduction of machine guns, and the 1895 Colt, which is here, a great example of an early machine gun that was used by the United States. 2 of these get sent to Cuba during the Spanish-American War. Did the U.S. Army buy machine guns? No. Did Tiffany, people, you know, Tiffany Lamps, Tiffany, his son served in the 1st U.S. Volunteer Cavalry, and so the old man ponied up to buy a section of machine guns for the cavalry regiment, which was commanded by Leonard Wood. It's not just a story about young men, it's a story about young Americans. Women had a role as well in Jefferson Barracks. There was the Women's Auxiliary Corps were here. We had WACS, and as well as the Women's Army Nursing Corps, which had a very significant presence at the post as well. The U.S. Army Air Corps even had an auxiliary with female pilots, the WASPs, who would transport aircraft.
Have you ever heard of Kathy Williams, who enlisted as William Cathay and was the only woman to serve in the Buffalo Soldier regiments? And she enlisted here at Jefferson Barracks. Some of the more obscure but still important, the first successful parachute jump from an airplane took place on the parade ground at Jefferson Barracks in March of 1912. Albert Berry jumped, he was strapped to the struts of a biplane. He untied himself or unsnapped himself from the struts and he jumped. He said it was a very hard landing, but he was good.
Oh, hear us when we
so much history that people would be excited to know, but don't. But in my estimation, as far as a continuously active post, Jefferson Barracks is probably, if not the most important, right up there in the top.
My name is Bill Hershey. I am a professional taps bugler. I started playing taps out here in March of 2000. So it's been about 10 years at Jefferson Barracks National Cemetery. Taps is just a soulful 24 notes, 24 beautiful notes. And I try to make every note just sound just beautiful. It's really an honor to play taps to the veterans. Back in 1898, an Army bugler one day came up with the 24 notes of taps. He wrote it down, and he played it one night at 9 p.m., and people heard that, and it just caught on, and then it became taps for the funerals. So that's where it started, back in 1898. The first taps I played was in the Army band at Arlington National Cemetery, my first taps ever. I saw the widow weeping, the firing party fired, I played taps and my lips started to quiver, I got emotional about it, I missed a couple notes, the sound was not that desirable, and after it was over, I had to tell myself, hey, you can't get emotionally involved, and from that moment on, I just focused on the notes, how it sounds to make it sound as beautiful as I could, and I've never gotten nervous again. In my opinion, when the family hears live taps, I think it just brings emotion to the surface, and it's really the final farewell salute to their loved ones.